The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. On this edition, I am joined by the pop punk lass. We're on the continuous road with Rosie Nyte. Welcome to the show.
Hi. How are you?
I am very well. I'm very busy as well, which is nice, especially in lockdown, to be busy.
Yeah, we need to get busy, don't we?
Absolutely. I know you've been finding excellent ways to keep yourself busy, which we'll definitely get onto. But the first question is always the same. How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
So it's actually like quite a weird story, actually. So I used to watch it, stereotypical, watched it as a kid with my wee brother, who is Logan Smith. Big shock if anyone didn't know that. So he debuted in the ring and I went down to watch him, obviously big supportive sister, all that. And as I was watching it, I was watching it and I was going, I bet I could do that. And it was that kind of cocky big sister of, that's nothing, I bet I could do that. It looks easy. And then he was like, well, why don't you come down and see how you get on? He went, I bet you won't even last a month. And here I am 4 years down the line.
You did
all right
then. You did all right.
Yeah, I'm getting somewhere.
So when you're watching then, who was the first ones, who's first wrestlers that kind of caught your eye?
It must have been Looking Sharp, definitely. Like, just that kind of like out there character. I was just like, he is cracking. And even in person, obviously, he's the exact same kind of person. But I just watched him and I was like, this is phenomenal. And then, obviously, over at the stand, there was, like, just a couple of girls, one of them being Angel Hayes. And I was like, I wonder why the girls aren't wrestling. And at the time, I spoke to Angel, and I said to her, why are you not wrestling? Like, are you barred or something? Are you not debuted? And she's like, there's just not enough girls. So that kind of, like, piqued my interest as well. Like, there's not enough girls. We could probably change that. So there we are.
And of course, you and Angel have, that was your first match, but of course you've got a bit more closer relationship because Angel is with Logan as well. So it's like, it went from what you doing to practically family now.
Yeah, basically I see Angel, God, far too much, I would say. Like, she's like the annoying little sister, like, about my age that you need, but honestly, I love the girl with all my heart, but yeah, she's definitely like a wee sister to me. She's been part of the family now for 6 years, so it doesn't even like faze me when she just shows up randomly into my room to ask me a question, and I'm like, what are you doing here?
So training then, as I know, from the school that you're at, it was Matt's first of all, I've spoke to a lot of people from that particular school or schools. Mm-hmm. What was it like? I mean, if you're watching it going, oh, that's a ring, that looks amazing, I'll give that a go. And then coming in and seeing it's all mats, what were your first thoughts?
Yeah, originally I was like, right, okay, so how do you guys train? But obviously in the beginning, the kind of, if you're first starting, you get sent over to like crash mats to kind of learn how to bump safely and kind of start to learn a bit of chain. And I'd been pulled away by Lucy Cole and Angel took me away. So that was at the time where Angel kind of took training me, and it kind of felt a bit strange because I was like, I see you every single day and now you're training me. Like, this is mental. But then I couldn't get my head around the fact that they were wrestling on mats. I was like, is that not sore? Like, how are they doing that on mats? That must be agonizing. And lo and behold, yes, it was agonising, but I think the good thing about it for me, I thought, is it taught us, like, kind of how to control ourselves, like, without there being a ring, like, ending up, like, just trying to learn this spot and that spot, we kind of learned more technical, and I found that did interesting. Obviously, at shows, we got kind of in-ring training, and we started learning how to run ropes there. I just, obviously it's a completely different way for everyone else, but to me it was kind of, it taught us a lot of kind of discipline with what if there wasn't ropes, like what if something happened in the match and you couldn't use the ropes, what are you going to do then? So yeah, I mean, it was a shock, and I think my back took the shock pretty well.
So then you made your debut, I think it was about a year and a half afterwards? And it was against Angel. So what was it like going to that first match then?
I mean, it was nerve-wracking, because obviously I'd been training the year and a half before, but halfway through that year I took 6 months out because I went to go work in America. So during that time I wasn't wrestling at all. So I came back, and I remember the moment I got sat down, it's like, you're going to make your debut. I was like, wait, what? It was nerve-wracking, but obviously because it was Angel, I knew I had somebody that would look after me in the ring, and she'd kind of guided me for day one. So for me, it was kind of, I felt safe. But I loved every minute of it, especially because it was like main event. I absolutely loved every minute of it. And I mean, now that I look back on it, I'm kind of like, wow, I was so proud of that. But yeah, I mean, I'll still be proud of it because it was the day I debuted. But yeah, definitely, I felt completely safe. Obviously, the nerves were eating me up every time somebody went out, because I knew it was getting closer and closer to my match. But with having somebody like Angel on your back, you don't worry about it.
Absolutely. I mean, especially your first match is main event. That's a bit terrifying in itself. And I was going through, I trust the Germans at Cage Match for all my match information, unless there's one I obviously know is missing. So, yeah. I mean, your journey from that point, you did a fair bit of travelling. From just then, because I think, what was it, Livingston, you started the first match, and then, of course, you did places like Airdrie and all that kind of thing, and then you were sitting at SWA. So what was it like just getting in front of all these different crowds? What was it like getting in front of a crowd in the first place? So are you quite a, introvert, is that the word? Well, whatever the opposite is to introvert. Are you quite an outgoing person? Are you quite, just was ready for it?
I mean, I've always been kind of like a going person. Like, all my friends would say, like, I literally will talk until you're blue in the face. But obviously, with it being, you're not just focusing on the fact that there's a crowd, you're focusing on, what have I got to remember in here? What am I going to do next? What if something goes wrong? And there's, like, so much playing on your head in that moment where you're just kind of like, what if somebody shouts something in the crowd? Is it going to distract me? Am I going to forget? But, like, once being in front of a crowd, the adrenaline it gives you, like, just the way a crowd reacts, like, the way they bring you up if you're a face, like, they'll actually support you so much, or they'll absolutely despise you. I mean, you've got either end of the spectrum, but it's nerve-wracking to begin with sometimes. I mean, obviously, when I done SWA, Clyde Bank, I'm sure, was the kind of first big one I done. And I remember being like, oh my God. I was like, look, showed up to the venue and I'm like, what is with the size of this? I don't think I can do this. So I'm freaking out backstage, and I've got the likes, obviously, for that match I was wrestling Jokey. And she was like, to me, you need to calm down. It's all right. All you need to focus on is me and me only. And I'm like, right, okay. And I'm like, trying to breathe. Come on, calm down. Just about to go out. And I remember her giving me a hug and saying, just pay attention to me, forget the crowd are there. And once I went out, like, she just kind of kept her eyes on me the full time, just kind of like, I'm here. And from that moment, I kind of, like, distinguished the fact, let's not worry about the crowd, let's worry about the person that's in the ring with you. Like, it becomes your own little kind of phased out area is the ring, and then the crowd are in the background until you kind of react to the crowd. And then when you react to the crowd, it's just like, right, they've gave me that rush of adrenaline that I needed to keep going. I think fans are the absolute best in a crowd. Like, you need them there, they create the ring.
Absolutely. I mean, as long as they're making some sort of noise, you can worry about the specific noise when you need to. I suppose.
Exactly.
As long as they're chanting for you, if you're the face, of course, then you can be, right, I've got that in the back pocket. If I need it, I'll bring them in. But
exactly.
It is difficult to, I mean, I'm sure there's probably been points, especially when you're doing like camps and that, where you've been like, right, nobody's reacting. I'm just gonna have a go at it.
I've had one show where that happened, where there was like literal no reaction at all, and it must have been the most, and it wasn't just my match, it was like everybody's match, and it was so awkward. I'm like that, like, come on guys, and then I'll just sit there like, I'm like, what's going on?
You know, it's not gonna go well if you kind of get come on guys to get folk to at least clap.
That's
death sentence to whole show. So I mean, you're traveling. I was going through this list, and it didn't have Mega Slam, but I know you're quite into Mega Slam, and you've end up traveling quite a bit of the country because of it. How did you get involved with them?
Originally, it was I'd offered to drive to a Dunoon show, and I drove down, and while I was there, I got asked to like do the filming, like just to film a couple of the matches just for the website. And I did, and I kind of got talking to the promoter of Mega Slam, and eventually it was Lizzie Styles came into Mega Slam quite frequently. And obviously the perks, I was a driver, and they needed a driver for the show and a female. So at the time, it was one of the boys that put my name forward for it. He was like, why don't you try Rosie? So he brought me down, I wrestled Lizzie, and then it became like every single weekend I was wrestling Lizzie.
So just luck then, just right place, right time.
Yeah, just basically, obviously, been helping at the show, like showing face and kind of helping out with the ring, and then helping with kind of the merch or anything you needed help with, I kind of helped with it at the Dunoon show. And then it became a thing where one of the boys was like, do you remember the girl that helped at Dunoon? And he was like, yeah, why don't we bring her down then, because she can drive, it's kind of, that's a bonus, and we need somebody for Lizzie to wrestle. And then it just became a thing. Like, I just started going down quite a lot to wrestle Lizzie over and over again, but I could never get bored of wrestling Lizzie at all.
and places like Isle of Man and everywhere, just to do a bit of wrestling. Lizzie's one of those names that I've always like seen about, so she's quite experienced. Was that just every match was a learning experience for you?
Definitely. There was no match with Lizzie where I just didn't learn something. It could have been something so small, but I learned from her so good. Like, just her, the way her mind works for wrestling is amazing, like considering like how old she actually is, because she's a couple of years younger than me, I'm sure. And obviously she's debuted a lot earlier, but just her mind for wrestling is just, I'm like, can I just pick at your brain like every 5 minutes, please?
that's the thing. I mean, it seems these younger wrestlers nowadays, I mean, Looking Sharp being the example that I would use for anyone, he's 23, and probably has like the mind of someone who would twice the years on the clock, and at least. It's just incredible how, I think it's more a case of wrestlers, when we started or whatever, we've kind of seen the good and bad, so we're trying to make it better, I suppose,
at
the same time. I'll go back to your travel. As you'll soon find out, there is no set structure to this. I'll look down so often and see a note and go, right, I'll speak about that next.
Structure's boring anyway.
I don't have one, really. I mean, there has been episodes where I'm just about to wrap up and go, oh, I have another question. So, we'll get there eventually. Everything will be ticked off. You went to Ireland in 2019 as part of...
I went with Emily Hayden, actually. It was great. Both of us seemed to cause riots in the airport without managing to cause riots in the airport, like just running about shouting as two absolute idiot wrestlers would do. No, that was great. I mean, it was so random. I can't even remember exactly how that came about. It was just the promoter contacted me and Emily, and it just became like a thing that just happened. It was quite surprising because I was fully expecting, I'm like, right, a promoter's messaged about booking in Ireland, this is going to fall through. And I was so set on it falling through, but then he started to send through flights, and then he was like, ah, you can stay here for, like, at my house for the night, which he did, and he was absolutely fantastic. He was such a lovely guy. His name is Nick Campbell. Obviously, he wanted to bring me and Emily back over, but obviously we know Big Bad Rona appeared. So we never got a chance to go back over this year, but we're hopeful that he'll bring us back, because I had the time. I became a luchador during it for some random reason. I became known as Lucha Rosita or something. This became a thing. But I had a great time. Like, they were great over there. Like, even the crowd were great, and they were all dead appreciative, and all the wrestlers over there were, like, so accommodating. They were lovely. Like, everybody I spoke to was nothing but nice, and it was just a great atmosphere. We just kind of done the show and had a good laugh with it. It was great.
That's the thing, I suppose, when I can see why you think that someone from Ireland's suddenly wanting us to go over and wrestle. That could be a bit weird. I mean, especially when I was going through your Facebook, and of course, everyone's friend, Mr. Mormon, was on every single post of yours wanting to book you. So I can see how someone from Ireland could be a bit weird. Have you been to Ireland before then? Did you get to do some of the sights with Emily, or was it just a case of wrestling?
No, we didn't manage to do the sights and that. It was kind of like do the show. Got a KFC though, can't rule that out. Go to bed, get back up and get our flight home. But we've made like a really close friendship with one of the girls just in one day. It's a referee, Hayley the Tiny. She's an absolutely amazing girl. Like, she was so nice, like, dead respectful, but firm. Like, I've never got any trouble off a ref before, and it was kind of scary getting into trouble off her. I was like, all right, calm down, sorry. But we made friends with her, and we're hopeful if we can come back over, we can. She's just bought a lovely new house. So, Hayley, we're coming to stay for a couple of days.
I've heard nothing but good things about Hayley. I mean, I see her on, of course, Twitter and that, and she's just, like, sounds like the most positive person ever. Which, I mean, I suppose is pretty good. Emily's up there as one of the most positive people, and from our brief chat, I can tell you are as well. So it's the most positive experience ever, just hanging about with the three of us, I could tell.
Positive trio.
And our place that, again, we're going for jumping about a bit, but you went to Eve in 2019 as well.
I did, yeah.
Is, I would say, well, easily one of the top two all-women promotions. Top three, maybe.
Yeah.
In the UK. Yeah. And, of course, it was against Angel. Of course it was.
Of course it was.
What was it like getting inducted into the girl gang down in Eve?
Oh, I got the message the night before. Basically, Piper, as people might know her now, Piper Niven, but whatever one she's going by the now, but Viper to me. So she needed a driver to go down, and kind of my name was suggested to take them down because I could drive, and there was a spot available to wrestle Angel, and everyone was like, we may as well fling in Rosie because it's with Angel. So, but it was absolutely nerve-wracking. Like, however, like, the atmosphere at Eve is phenomenal. Like, having all the girls backstage and everyone's just kind of supporting each other, it was such a great atmosphere. So yeah, then again, it was with Angel. I mean, it wasn't one of my best performances, and I can, like, honestly say that it wasn't one of my best, and I completely to this day will just say it I was the most nervous person known to man that day. Like, I'm pretty sure I went over the match about 200 times. Even before I went out, I was like, Angel, what have we done? Like, it was just, my head was all over the place. But the crowd there as well, absolutely great. Like, they were just shouting, like, Glasgow, Glasgow. Like, because it was me and Angel, they were like, Glasgow, Glasgow. It was just like, what's going on?
I mean, I suppose as well, if you've just driven, if you found out the night before and you're driving down to London,
yeah,
it's quite a bit to actually just get yourself prepared for that as well.
Yeah, no, it was kind of like I'd just finished my shift, I was ready to go for a nice warm bath, and it's like, hey, do you want to debut Eve tomorrow? And I was like,
Yeah, I'd be terrified. I mean, I've only ever been down to London just on a plane or everything, and going around that area, I mean, it's Bethnal Green, isn't it? And I've just seen the traffic, I'm thinking, nah, me driving it. I would never drive down there.
Not great.
Just to swing back for a second, you mentioned you did pick up a KFC when you're in Ireland, and I love KFC. So what's your order?
Oh, my order at KFC. So I'm a mixture, but see, like, what I'll always go back to is a Phillip Tower box meal, but I have to get like 8 extra hot wings. But right, me and my partner have like became obsessed and seem to be buying like the 12 piece of boneless on top of like another 16 hot wings. It's getting out of control, but there has to be hot wings in my order. I don't care what it is, as long as there's hot wings.
I'm the same. It's like, I don't know what happens. I usually go for Big Daddy box meal. That's my usual order.
Good choice. Good choice.
But I always have to have, doesn't matter what we have, I have to have the 2 hot wings for 99p. Has to happen. Doesn't matter if anything else, I have to get that. Although
I can't leave without hot wings. Like, I got told in Top Secret, that I was at the drive-thru the other day there, Top Secret, apparently there's a hot wing bucket coming out, and I'm so ready for it.
I don't think my body's ready for it, but I would certainly give it a go. As soon as they go, 9AP, yes, it's less than a pound.
Sure, that's a bargain.
Exactly, even though you spent like 30 quid on 2 meals, it's like, oh, I've got to have 9AP wings.
They're like 8 hot wings for £3, and I'm like, of course.
So, again, we're just throwing ourselves about here. You've also made debuts for Uproll.
Yes.
As well, Respect, Wrestling Experience Scotland, pretty much everywhere. Just about in Scotland, especially you haven't been in for whatever reason. So what's been some of your favourite matches that you've had?
So one of my favourite, and I can honestly say, like, is like top of the like par of one of my favourites, has got to be my match at Fierce Females with Chantel Jordan. That girl is phenomenal. Like, I wrestle her every single day of the week, easily. And her age, like being 16 and being able to produce that.
The sound's cut out. What's happened here? Be a moment, the sound has cut out.
Right, you lose me there.
Yeah, I lost you. You were saying Chantel Jordan was amazing. That's for 16, and then that was it.
Sorry, I don't know what's going on. So I would wrestle her every day of the week, easily. I just think she's great. So she right now is one of my favourites.
I think you end up, did you wrestle her back-to-back days in different companies? Am I right?
Yeah, so I wrestled her for the belt at Shield Pro. And then the next day, I wrestled her again at Fierce Females.
I think I saw you did you put a clip up of you doing a tornado DDT, I think it was, Sally DDT.
Yeah.
Which looked just amazing. Just like so good. So that leads us nicely on to, well, we've got a couple of forks in the road where we can go, but we're going to go to Shield, because that is where you won the Shield Almost Pro Women's Championship. Again, was it against Angel?
Yes.
It was, of course it was.
I took Angel's belt.
So what's it like going down to Shield and then getting the belt?
I mean, like, I first went down in, I think it was a February, and it was me against it was either Marcy or Emily. That's terrible, I can't remember, but it was one of the two. So I went down there, and I just, you know that way when, like, you go somewhere and you just fit in? Like, it just, you don't even need to, like, try to feel welcome, you're just instantly welcome. Like, that's how it became. And then every, kind of, like, once I'd done my first match, they were like, yeah, I mean, you've got a brilliant Italian round the corner, of course I'm going to come back. So, they just eventually kept bringing me back, and obviously, Angela, we all know, she's in leaps and bounds. We still can't understand why Angel hasn't got a contract yet, but we're working on it. But so we knew kind of she was beginning to climb the ladder, and she was becoming a bit more kind of busy and stuff like that. So every time I was going down, it was wrestling Marcy or Emily. And it came to the September time, like probably about August, and he asked me if I was available for the Shieldiversary show.
I've lost you again. So what's happening with this? Technology is wonderful when it works. I heard I hear something now.
Well, I don't know what's going on. This is weird.
It's just like I said before we started, we're both working with the most ancient equipment. And if you try your headphones again, we'll see if that's kind of.
Yeah, I feel like it might actually be the internet, to be honest.
Yeah, that can be a pain.
Yeah, the great old internet. I'm going to turn off the internet on everything I own right now. No, so I was asked to go down for the September show, and I just kind of told them I was available. And they said it's against Angel for the belt. And I was like, all right, cool, sounds good. Me and Angel wrestled about 10 billion times by now. I'm sure it'll be fine. We'll get down there, get it done. So I went down, and they were all kind of like making a fuss backstage. And I was like, what's going on? So we went round, and he was like, here's your call sheet. And on the call sheet, it had obviously been put down for me to take the belt. And I was kind of like, what? Like, what's going on? That was a surreal moment, because obviously it was my first belt, and I was just kind of like, wait, what have I done to deserve this belt? And it was just, they were just a company. I could never turn around to them and say, no, I don't work for you, because honestly, I couldn't. Every time I go down, I just have an amazing time. And I mean, they literally will accommodate anything. Like, they're the type of company that will ask you who you want to wrestle, and they'll try and bring them for you. And obviously you don't go like exact advance, like, oh, bring me a Kaylee Ray. Like, they're going to be like, no. But they're willing to accommodate for us, like, who we want to wrestle. And kind of like, if we're running a bit late down through Scotland, we give them a message and we're like, listen, we're running late. They'll be like, that's fine, we'll change the card. Like, they're just a phenomenal company, and the promoters are nothing but lovely to you. They're really nice. Like, anything you need, they're kind of willing to just help. Like, I just, it's a company I couldn't big up more than what it already gets credit for anyway. It's a fantastic company.
And you were celebrating at the Italian afterwards, of course.
Oh yeah, definitely. Straight to Toscano's. Straight to Toscano's.
But no, I really, I like Shield's belt as well. It's also, it's so like, I don't know, video gamey kind of thing. It's got like the big, the shield, obviously. But it's just got that kind of like bits at the side. If anyone's seen it, they'll know what I'm trying to get at. So yeah, Shield has been a good place for you. I think I watched the anniversary show when there was either no shows on or I had nothing to watch that particular weekend. Yeah. I ended up watching it, and I like their setup. It seems they have their stories, but if they don't need a particular story, it is just sometimes just wild matches. And like I say, if you give them respect with going get me so-and-so, and you're not turning around going, right, I would like Viper and everyone from NXT UK, and then they'll respect you in return. So it's...
Yeah, exactly. They're really, really good that if you kind of have a preference of somebody that you want to kind of wrestle, they'll kind of take that into consideration, and obviously to an expense, because obviously when we go down, they actually like bring a full car full down of like talent from up here. So obviously expense wise, if there was like a female up here that I kind of went, I'd love to bring her down, they would probably accommodate it. It's kind of more, obviously they're not exactly a big massive company, so asking for people like Kaylee Ray and Viper would be like, yeah, no.
But if you're hanging about and you want to take Ashley Vega down or something like that, it's like, aye, absolutely, just pull the car with you. That was the first name that came to my head. I think it was just because she's recently been followed by Mickey James, so it's all over her.
I know.
Which,
jealous.
So, I'm going to throw about. I read that you have a rubber duck collection.
Yes.
How did that start and why?
So it all started when I lived in the States. So I lived in the States, and me and one of the girls there, her name's Monica, she's like my best pal from the States. Well, she still lives over there, but she is still my best friend today. Talk to her just about every day. So we were out in the camp one night, and like we just kind of like were walking about, and randomly on a patch of grass was just this rubber duck. And we don't know how it got there, why it got there, because there was like no kid seemed to have a rubber duck with them. And it was just this rubber duck sitting on a patch of grass. And I just like kind of picked it up, and it became like our son. Like, so weird. I mean, camp sends you loopy, you're around Wayne's 24/7, you become a child. So this child became our son, and we called it Quack Efron. And kind of from there, I've just started collecting random rubber ducks. Like, I've got like Spyro ones, I've got Santa ones, I've got Harry Potter ones. It just became a bit crazy.
So how many do you reckon you have in your collection right now?
Right now, I probably have about 50 to 60 rubber ducks lying about the house.
I didn't expect that number. I was like, oh, I've got about 15 or so. No, 15. No. No.
That's right. Every time I see a rubber duck, I feel like I need to buy it. And then my partner just keeps buying me rubber ducks whenever she sees them. So it's just became a vicious cycle.
I'm absolutely the same with things like my wife loves Harry Potter. Harry Potter rubber ducks. And she's, for some reason, it's come to the point, every time I go into a charity shop or anything, if I see a Harry Potter book she hasn't got, she's got all of them. But if I see one that she hasn't got that particular style, if it's a hardback and she hasn't got it, or if it's a particular collection that she hasn't got, I'm like, I'm going to buy that. And she's got a whole shelf full. She's got about 7 copies of Philosopher's Stone at this point, all different ones. And I don't know how it started, but it's still continuing because we need a hardback Goblet of Fire. I need to find one of those.
Yeah.
And you have to get it from a charity shop. It's not fun if you order online.
Oh, definitely. You got.
Against the game.
Yeah.
You also have been playing Fortnite as well.
Yes.
Never played Fortnite. Well, I played it once. I got really confused and everyone was killing me. And... I got scared. I was like, no, I'm going to go play Spyro or something instead. how did you get into the Fortnite world? Do you know all the dances?
I mean, I don't know any dances, so I'm not ready to start doing like this is that or something. I don't
I have no idea.
I've always kind of like played video games. Like I love like the likes of Grand Theft Auto and Mafia and things like that. And at the beginning of lockdown, it was like I was just bored beyond belief, like absolutely devastatingly bored, until obviously I started my job. So I was waiting to start that, and my friend played that, and he messaged me, my best friend, sorry, I should say that right in case he watches and goes off his nut that I called him my pal. My best friend messaged me and was like, why don't you join me and a group of the boys on Fortnite? And I was like, well, why not? Like, it's not going to hurt. So, yeah, it just became an obsession where I was, like, even playing with my little sister who's 10. And then now it's, like, me, my partner and her friend all play Fortnite at night time. Even her sister will join in sometimes. Like, it's just became, like, this whirlwind of, like Fortnite bros, as we call it. Like, it's just so sad, but it's such a funny game because your pal dies and you're like, you're trying to save them and it's just, you're getting shot at. It's like a battlefield. It's brilliant.
But I've seen all these people just like throw up constructions and I'm still figuring out how to, I was figuring out how to do that. And I got died.
5-star hotels.
No, and I was just like, nah, I'm going to go back and play something I don't die in as often. I'll play Lego games.
I always say that. I'm like, they're building a five-star hotel with, like, a spa, sauna, like, reception, everything. It's just, like, they're not really. They've literally built, like, a wee brick house. And I'm still sitting there with the controls, like, I can't build the house.
I know. Minecraft's another one for me that I started playing and was like, nah, I've
no. Oh, no, I can't play Minecraft. That game threw me off completely. I was like, why have I got a brick in my hand and what do I do with the brick in my hand? And why is there wee ghosts following me? I don't know what to do.
That's it. And it's like, you look through the wee guide and says, oh, kill a pig. It's like, how? I don't know what I'm doing. I've got a brick. That's not helping. I thought it would. But, you know, it's just, I don't understand gaming nowadays. I'll stick to, I play like the wrestling ones, obviously. That's about it. That and the Lego games.
I just completed Mafia 3, so I'm sitting now with nothing to do.
I've been like picking up games like Psychonauts I've completed Spyro, but I want to play that kind of game, and I'm not playing Crash Bandicoot again because I like to keep my TV. And
I played that once, and I will never play it again. I'm pretty sure my remote got the brunt of it. I'm like, I don't remember it being this hard when I was 10.
I'm the same. I remember rattling through it when I was 10 when it came out. Ridiculous. So you mentioned that you're working during this lockdown, but you're doing a bit more important than I am. I'm sitting in my office space clicking buttons. But you went on to be a healthcare system.
Yes.
So, which is to say, it's a bit more important than what I've been doing. But what made you decide to do that during this time?
Last year, I kind of was like stuck between jobs. Like I was a microbiologist before, kind of went on kind of healthcare, but I never really fully enjoyed that. I was working in a lab in Edinburgh as in a high school. So I was the one that kind of like brought out your sheep's hearts and gave you them and set up your experiments for you. And I just wasn't happy. Like I just didn't feel happy. And I moved to Livingston, but I moved back home to Glasgow for a bit. Like last year I moved back to Glasgow. And obviously at that point I was like, I don't want to be in a lab anymore. So it was the beginning of January, I went, maybe I should do nursing. I mean, I like people, so I suppose I could be all right in nursing. So I was like, right, I'll apply and then I'll get a job in care. And then if I don't actually enjoy being a carer, then there's no way I'm going to enjoy being a nurse full time. So I'd applied to the uni and stuff like that, and I went on and I got a care role, and I loved it. Like knowing kind of like you were the face somebody was excited to see because you were their only company, or you're making a difference to somebody's day because they just need that extra bit of help and you're there to kind of motivate them to do it. And I was just like, this is what I should be doing. And then when COVID struck, I was kind of cautious about going into people's houses because I've got a big family and we all kind of worked in and out. And obviously it sounds quite silly that I was cautious, but I think I was more feared to bring it to them at the time. So the NHS started doing a COVID intake, and I was like, maybe I should just apply, see what happens. If I can, maybe if I start in the hospitals, I'll be able to get even a more real feel of being a nurse. So applied, got the job, and here I am today. I was working in COVID units, 8 in the morning to 8 at night. I was like doing night shifts, 8 at night to 8 in the morning, and it was in COVID units, full PPE, like with the face shields, the masks, the gowns. And I mean, to this day, I still work there. Like, I've kind of dulled down. I was working just 5 days a week during COVID. Like, I wasn't even stopping it. I was doing 12-hour shifts for 5 days straight, and I was barely taking a break. And it got to about August, and I'd been accepted to do nursing. So I decided, yeah, I definitely want to go ahead with this. And I'm obviously now I'm studying to be a nurse, but I've dulled down how many hours I'm doing in the hospital now, and I've kind of went back to home care because I've moved from Glasgow now up to Cumnock. So I stay in Ayrshire now. And so between driving back to Glasgow to work and being at uni, I kind of dulled down the hours, but I'm still kind of there every week, still fighting against this mess that's happened.
I'm just fascinated that you seem to be like you're always busy. I mean, you started training to be a wrestler and then stopped just to go do a camp in America, come back, then you're a wrestler, and then you're a microbiologist. And is there anything you can't do except do funny dances?
There's probably quite a lot, to be honest. I can't adult. Is that a thing?
That's a boring thing to do. I'm still learning. Although, saying that, I got super excited last week because we got a drinks trolley, which made me feel really old at the same time. It's like going, oh no, I shouldn't be excited about this.
I got a new Hoover and a washing machine, and I've never seen excitement like it. Like, I was absolutely buzzing, like waiting for the delivery driver of the washing machine. Like, is it coming? Is it coming?
Oh, it's one of those shark Hoovers.
Not quite as bougie as that.
Oh, we've got one because we've got a dog. And
although I got a pet, I've got a pet hair one. I think it's like Vax or something with that. And because we just rescued a dog, so currently battling with her.
And then adding that to your list of things that's going on. So what kind of dog have you got?
So we've just rescued a husky staffy cross. She's kind of, she's been in homes where they've not really been able to look after her properly, and there was like no ever proof of her having like vet vaccinations or anything. So we've had to go through the full process. I think she's the lowest, stupidest thing I've ever met.
You haven't met my dog then. No, mine's a Beagle Lab cross.
I want a Beagle. That's my dog choice, a Beagle. I want a Beagle.
Well, we were looking for one. I don't know. We looked at Gumtree one day and we're like, oh, I really want a dog. We don't want a big dog. Just like a Beagle maximum. And then we saw this puppy, Beagle Lab cross. So we thought, well, we'll take a chance and hope that it's a Beagle size and not a lab size.
With a lab size.
Thank God, no, it's Beagle size.
Oh, good.
It just looks like a lab, so that means if she's an absolute pain in the neck outside, we just go, oh, she's just a puppy.
She's just a baby. We don't get away with that. Like, people are so weird, like, where we are living. Like, she's got the staffy face, yeah, but, like, she's such a lovable soul. She just wants everyone to be her pal. Like, that's all she wants. And, like, she'll sit on the couch with us and cuddle in like she's a 5-year-old, and she lies all over us as if she's a lap dog. But there's people that will walk by her and cross the street and be like, oh no, that's a staffy, I don't want to go near her. And I think that's horrible. Like, she's only one. She's just wanting pals. Like, she just loves everybody.
That's the thing. Folk don't understand. It's not the dog that...
No.
It's the people. Exactly.
Yeah.
But no, Sandy Claus is our whole name because my wife met her for Christmas. And yeah, she's If you check my Instagram or anyone listening to watch this wants to see my dog, usually I'll put a picture of her up on pay-per-view night because she stays up with me and then falls asleep before the first match starts.
that sounds like me for pay-per-views as well.
Well, I mean, if it wasn't for the Thunderdome, I think I'd be the same, to be honest.
Yeah.
I'm staying up just to see my face. That's about it. And then I do, and then they move me, which hurts my feelings a little bit. I know, I was in one of the opening matches for Elimination Chamber. I was like, yes, third row. And then I turned around and I was gone. And then I wasn't seen the rest of the night.
That's just so rude.
I know, I was looking at it going, what's up my face? And then there's folk that are quote-unquote...
They couldn't do that at live shows. They couldn't move you then.
Oh, imagine if you were just at a live show and you saw someone looked a bit odd and you just went, nah, put him over there.
Third row.
Get him in the corner.
Away, corner. Away to the nosebleed.
So yeah, you've been super busy. But we've also seen you pop up in things like Ask Advice Speech, and this will be the heavy portion of the show because it was, of course, right. Mental health. Which you're a big advocate for speaking about it. So what made you convinced you to take part in that advice speech video and just put yourself out there for people?
So lockdown's had a big effect on everyone. It's been horrible. We've all had to adapt to this new normal. I hate the expression because I don't think there should be a new normal. Like, it's we need to get back to normal, not a new normal. But we're all feeling the effects of it. Like, during lockdown as well, like, I lost my nana. And during the time that Emily asked me to kind of do the advice speech stuff, I'd went for a breakup. I'd lost my nana. I'd lost, obviously, my flat. I'd had to move back home. I'd lost kind of everything, and that's me just like opening up to people because at the time my head wasn't in a great place either, but I managed to find my way back to that place, obviously with the support of family and support of like the likes that Emily and Angel, you're kind of your wrestlers that do become family to you. And obviously we've got Jesse's, well I say Jesse Santana, he doesn't exist anymore, like shame on A. He's also one of my best pals. Like, I could go to him yet. And then he helped me a lot during lockdown and kind of dealing with my mental health. And joining in wasn't even like a, oh, I need to think about it. It was like, yeah, like, people need to see, like, wrestlers, we're real people too. We have feelings. Like, we're allowed to hurt. We're allowed to feel down. And I'm kind of putting myself out there vulnerable to show people, yeah, I feel like this too. It's affecting all of us. And it's not just because wrestling's gone, it's because we're losing friends, we're not seeing family, we're not getting to see each other. It's like our routine's completely messed up, our minds are everywhere. And as I say, it's like I myself suffered with like depression, anxiety for years and years and years. And I kind of wanted to put myself out there vulnerable and offer kind of support if anyone needed just to talk to somebody, like, that didn't know them and wasn't aware of kind of what was going, like, somebody that didn't actually know them personally and kind of knew, like, one side of the story, next side if it was a situation. So, yeah, I just, like, to this day, I would still say to anyone, if you're feeling vulnerable or you need to talk to somebody, just message me. I've literally not privated my DMs or anything on Twitter so that if somebody is feeling like that, they can come talk to me. Like, I will message them back and I will speak to them. I don't need to necessarily know why you're feeling like that. Like, you don't need to tell me. But even if you're just feeling rubbish and you're just like, I need to talk to somebody, message me and say, can you please talk to me? Okay, I'll take that as a hint. You need somebody to talk to? That's fine. Like, we all kind of need to support each other. Like, we all need to get through this. And that's why I joined in. Like, we're all in the same situation. We're all in the same mindset. And we all kind of need to come out of this together, like, not feeling the way that we did in the beginning. Like, we want to come out strong and ready to kind of take on the world again, essentially. Like, get things back to normal. And if overheads are everywhere, we're not going to get back to normal.
Absolutely. I've said in a couple other interviews, so if anyone's listened to this, regular listeners will know, I'm just going to tell the same thing I say every time. But I'm at the point, I'm not a people person. I'm quite happy with my own company. If I'm given the choice to stay at home, I'll likely take it. I'm at this point where I'm like, I want to be able to go for lunch. I want to be able to just go to a place. And it's not so much like missing people, but it's just missing the option. I like to have the choice to stay at home. I don't want to be told to stay at home.
I mean, no doubt once everything opens up again, I'll be like, I could go out, but I want to stay in.
That's exactly it. I mean, this is why I do the podcast anyway. This is my social interaction now.
Yeah.
Because, even I was starting to miss it. And it, you don't get that awkward bit at the end where one of us has run out of something to say and we're just starting the boot. Because I know I do that at wrestling shows because I'm quite an introvert person when I'm meeting people face to face. So if I've run out of things to say, I'll just walk off.
It's just going to stand in there like, go. Yeah,
I don't know when to jump in either. So if someone's like, if I'm willing to get a wee picture with someone and they're speaking to someone already, I'll just hang about like
some sort
of and then go, picture. But yeah, this way I don't need to. I can get rid of you if you want, or you can get rid of me if I wanted to bring that up because it was something. I mean, Emily was just firing out loads of things, and this was like something that I think I knew people needed to see and needed to hear because, like you're saying, it's not the new normal. It's not a thing. It's evolution of normal. That's normal.
Yeah.
And it was great to see so many people be involved and pretty much just open themselves up to say, look, I'm feeling this too. Just speak about it and
we'll
do all that.
Exactly.
But let's go to happier things because this is
a podcast.
We'll speak about videos and what have you. How much fun did you have doing your Fierce Females stuff with Angel as Angels of the Night? I especially liked that you called Tinder the Tinder, and the shout out to Bebo was also close to my heart there. But how much fun did you have doing those things?
I mean, as obviously we've stated many times, me and Angel are like sisters, best pals. Like we've got along since we met, and that's just it. And I mean, as I say, she comes to everything, like birthday celebrations. Like she's always there. Angel's always creeping, and it's just. But getting to actually be a part of her, like to tag with, like such, like, I mean, for obviously. Even though I'm so older, like, you know that you're getting tagged with, like, one of the kind of biggest names in Scotland right now. Like, because you can't deny the girl is for her age as well. It's one of the biggest names now. Like, everybody knows who Angel Hayes is right now. Like, so getting told that I was getting paired with her, it was kind of like, right, well, we've never really been tagged partners, and I wonder how this is going to go down. And then the thing with Hannah Taylor just kind of happened randomly. Like, I don't even know why that happened. I couldn't even tell you where that came about. I don't even think it was a storyline. It just happened. And then just became a storyline. It became a thing. And, I mean, there's nothing else to say other than, like, it was great to laugh. Like, sitting with a phone, like, doing a promo, and I'm just chilling on my phone looking at, not even like I was on Tinder during it, but we'd literally set up the Tinder account, so I was a cocktail. And I think the funniest thing was that we've seen that actually people were liking the cocktail, and that's what we found more funny rather than the actual promo. But I mean, Angel of the Night isn't gone. Angels of the Night is still around, so
I'm just because I'm old, I'm going to need a bit of description of the vernacular. What's cocktail?
A cocktail?
I know what a drink is, just a cocktail, but what's a Tinder cocktail?
It's not, we literally just, rather than using photos of my face, we used a picture of a cocktail drink.
Ah, right, okay. Right, whew, okay. I had a thought what it was going to be. It was definitely not that, so that's fine. Oh, right. I'm going to get the ladder to get me out of this hole that I've dug. Let's take a...
I probably should have explained that a bit better.
I'm 30, but geez, I never felt so old in that moment. I'm just going, it's a cocktail? Right. Phew. Right. I mean, the next note I've looked at is your injuries, which I think is a bit of a come down from cocktail. But think about it, because you lost a bit of time to a torn ACL cruciate ligament. So you spent quite a bit towards, was it just before lockdown or just not? I remember there was a cast going about.
Just before lockdown, I actually fractured my talus in my foot. So my foot went through the ring and snapped, essentially.
Oh, God. Right.
So I drove home for the noon on the foot, didn't know anything. I knew it was sore, but I was like, okay, it's probably just a wee sprain. Like, I'll get over it, kind of. So I drove home for the noon, woke up the next morning, ready to go to training with Angel and Logan. And I was like, my foot's purple and black. So... went to the hospital and I found out that obviously I'd fractured my talus. And then I still was having quite a lot of difficulty with it till in like November-ish. So it'd been a while. So I'd done it. So it was actually a year yesterday I fractured my foot. So so it got to November and I was still having a lot of problems with it. And I went for an MRI. And the MRI showed that I've got 3 ruptured ligaments as well in the same foot. So essentially when I've fractured my foot, it's also ruptured my ligaments at the same time. But I've been doing physio for 6 months now and I got signed off last week. So
well, wasn't it nice of Corona to arrive just in time for that? So you're not missing any time. Yeah.
I know exactly.
That sounds awful. I mean, bones I've ever broken is my elbow, and it's the worst thing ever. Well, I thought it was the worst thing ever until I heard that. Because you get the one thing, just the break, and then everything else that comes with it. So, I mean, again, we're going back to you're doing that, and you're still doing healthcare and all that kind of thing. So, I mean, that's not going to be easy, is it?
No, I mean, it wasn't easy, no. So I eventually got insoles for my shoes. So basically in all my work shoes, I have like a wee platform that lifts my heel up so that when I'm walking out, I'm not pressure on my heel. So if I put pressure on my heel, that's where the pain comes from. So now I basically walk about for 12 hours with a wee heel platform, and it's pretty.
Right, so we'll move on. I've got a couple questions on the Twitter. First one was from, we'll go for Jason Hides first, because the one for Luke Cannon, I have many more questions with about it. So Jason Hides, he's put, do you miss holding your sleeve up to his sleeve so you can both proudly utter sleeves together?
Of course, I mean, our two sleeves are like the ultimate sleeves, so of course I do. There's not even a question. I don't even know why I'd ask such a silly question. Of course I must be like, sleeve.
I was starting to work on mine. I was finally putting them all together during lockdown, and then started closing tattooists again. I was like, oh.
Rona.
But no, I'm going to finish the bottom half. It's not an actual sleeve. It's just a bunch of tattoos that'll eventually...
It'll become a sleeve. That was what mine started like.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I'm just going to get it all done and go, right, tattoo artist, what do you put in the middle? Just
give me some form of tattoo, thanks.
No, pretty much. And of course, Luke Cannon, he says your best friend, he's asked, he's heard you've never watched Star Wars and refused to watch it. Explain.
Oh, he pesters me about this all the time, right? Does nothing stop me from watching Star Wars? One, I've never watched it. Yes, I can admit that. I've not watched Star Wars. But the fact that he continuously pesters me about not watching Star Wars, it makes me not want to watch it even more because I know it annoys him. And that's just my goal in life, is just to make sure that he's annoyed at all times. So if I can continue to annoy him via not watching Star Wars, I will do so.
I mean, the next stage, of course, is finally watching them and then liking them.
I mean, I probably will. I tried to watch them like 4 or 5 years ago, and I'm pretty sure I fell asleep during it. But maybe I wasn't like intellectual enough to watch it. Yeah.
No, I've seen the original trilogy, the prequel, and one of the new trilogy. You're not missing much, to be honest.
Yeah. He's so obsessed with Star Wars, and it annoys me that much that he's so desperate for me to watch it that I'm just like, no, look, I'm not doing it.
I tried. I should like it. I like superheroes, but
I love superheroes like Marvel, DC, right up my street. Apart from that, no.
Have you watched WandaVision then?
WandaVision?
Yeah.
No, yeah. No, yeah, it's on my list.
I suppose all these people, they're watching it at the time. Jeez, it's like everyone I've spoken to so far is like, no, I'm going to watch it when it's finished. No, watch it now.
It's on the list. I've got a long list to get through again.
So, yeah, favourite superheroes then? Who are your favourites?
It's got to be Iron Man. I just love Iron Man.
Iron Man or just Robert Downey Jr.?
Both, but then I really like the new Spider-Man as well.
Yes, like, yeah.
I just think it's so funny. Like, the new versions, I'm just like, I could just laugh at these all day. And then Deadpool, can't miss out Deadpool.
Yes. Rosie, we're on the same wavelength with all this. This is great. Because, Deadpool is probably one of my favourite. Spider-Man,
yeah,
absolutely. I remember watching not at the time, obviously, because I wasn't born, but the 1960s one, it used to be on just before I'd go do a paper round in the morning. So I'd watch that, and Spider-Man, always my favourite.
Deadpool I could watch like all the time and not be bored of watching Deadpool.
Absolutely, yeah. Definitely one of my comfort films to watch. Everyone's got one. It's just like, I could put that on.
Most girls, if they want to like kind of like perk their mood up, they'll kind of like, or like feel emotional, they'll watch like The Notebook, and then there's me, I'm like, I want to cry at Deadpool.
My wife says Forrest Gump. That's her film.
I love that.
To the point where we walked down the aisle, because I was already at the top, but she walked down the aisle to the actual Forrest Gump suite.
I love that. I'm here for that.
And we walked back down to Hooked on a Feeling by...
That is a tune. I've got that in vinyl, and I just, like, love it. Guardians of the Galaxy vinyl.
We've got it as well. Then our record player broke, and I was like, come on, this is just... But we had Deadpool on our wedding cake was just full of nerdy stuff. I got a Deadpool. Deadpool underneath had a Pixar Luxo ball, and it was probably one of the nerdiest wedding cakes you've ever seen.
I'm pretty sure my wedding cake will just be all Disney characters because I'm obsessed.
I don't know how this chat has gone to my wedding, but all of our tables were film names. So we had Deadpool. No, did we? I think we had Deadpool, but we changed.
I'll be disappointed if you didn't.
I had Deadpool, but initially I had all the old people on it. And I thought that might not be the best one to go with. Toy Story, Guardians of the Galaxy, and
love that
kind of stuff. So, yeah.
We're
that kind of people. Right, so we'll go for the weird questions that we generally have. One you've probably definitely heard of, because it's used to be a common one from your particular school. But the first one is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Probably a T-Rex, because they're so cute with these small arms, like me.
Fair enough. Yeah, T-Rex is quite a popular choice. And the second one is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
What?
What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I would say two sheep.
I say you're correct, but there doesn't seem to be a definitive answer. But
how? I mean, the cow is tall, but the sheep are small, so the sheep can just like get in about the knees while the cow doesn't know what's going on because it's too tall to see where the sheep are. Come on! Logic!
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I've had a wrestler that's a butcher part-time insists it was a cow, and I'm like, nah, it's two sheep. It's just the numbers.
It's definitely two sheep.
Yeah, madness. Right, yeah. So we'll swing back to wrestling chat, I suppose, as a wrestling podcast. You were recently announced to be part of the roster for Pro 2 Championship Wrestling, which, yes, of course, is in air, so that's handy.
Yeah, convenient now.
So how did that come about? Did Logan just randomly message you saying, are you Pro 2? Because that seems to be common. Or did you see it was coming up and just throw in a CV?
No, so I'd seen it come up, but obviously, like, I'd not mentioned it because I wasn't sure, like, if, like, people were already starting to kind of, like, start the rebooking process and, like, getting their shows sorted and getting their rosters sorted. But he messaged me and he kind of said that it'd be the news of me, could I send a CV? And just as I was, like, getting ready to send the CV, he was like, actually, never mind, don't need a CV, I've seen you, I know who you are. And then, yeah, that was it. He just asked if I was Pro 2, and we kind of got a bit talking because I asked him kind of where it was going to be based, and he found out that I lived in Cumnock, which is where he's going to do the shows. So, got a bit of talking, and here we are, been announced, and I'm actually looking forward to, like, a new kind of development company coming back up. Hopefully these guys can kind of reshape wrestling, essentially, like these kind of new companies coming up. And yeah, I mean, I'm excited for it. I'm excited to kind of get wrestling in where I'm living now and let my partner finally see me wrestle and see, like, bring her friends and family along as well. So it'll be exciting. It'll be fun.
I see that her name's announced, of course. Old adversary Angel Hayes is there. Because yeah. if it seems to be, if there's one he is, there's the other.
we come as a package.
Angels of the Night ride together, I suppose.
We do.
So what's your hopes then? Hopes and dreams, like, that's not how I mean. But for wrestling, when it comes back eventually, is there anywhere you want to particularly go? Is there any wrestlers you want to face? What's your kind of hopes in the next,
obviously, yeah, I mean, I'm hoping kind of in general, like, wrestling re-evolves. Obviously, I'm hoping that happens. And then I'm hoping as well for myself, like, just I continue to develop. Like, I get back into training, get back into the swing of things and continue to develop, because 4 years is a lot to just give up now. Like, I'm not going to just throw in till now, because it's been over a year since we all kind of stepped back in a ring. But in the future, I'd quite like to wrestle more down south. Like, I'd quite like to wrestle names that are known down south, and, like, I'd quite like to wrestle, like, your Lana Austins and your like, Lizzie's again, and just kind of all the well-known people down south, and kind of get back into the companies that I've done before that are still around and start making more of a name for myself up here. But also make my name for myself down here and start to kind of travel a wee bit further with it, like to Ireland again. But I would say essentially it's just to continue to develop and start to kind of shape myself into a professional wrestler. Obviously, I categorise as a professional wrestler, but I'm still training. I'm every day is training as a wrestler. There's no one that knows everything about wrestling. Like, new things evolve, it just kind of comes. So I would just like to kind of be more confident in myself when I'm about the ring, and confident when I'm stepping in the ring that I know what I'm doing, and get to know kind of other wrestlers. I mean, somebody that I'd love to kind of get into the ring with is Viper. Like, I'd love to step in the ring with Viper. she's like the mum of wrestling on top of like Kaylee. But like, either of they two, I'd love to kind of get the opportunity to even learn from. Like, doesn't need to be I'd go do a match with them. Like, I'd love to just kind of learn from them and experience kind of like what they would reckon. I mean, I was due to have a match with Isla Dawn, so I would love for that to kind of actually happen this time. Obviously, it kind of fell through because of number of reasons, but I really want to get it this time, because Isla Dawn's kind of, I've had training by Isla Dawn, so I know what she's like, and I'd just love to kind of get in the ring with her and learn from her. So there's just, my hopes and dreams is just to kind of continue develop and learn off kind of people who are once in my shoes, kind of thing. Yeah.
Just when you brought up Kaylee Ray again, it just seems to be someone that, someone who doesn't, I don't want to say it necessarily fits the generic mold as a wrestler, because she's a lot slimmer. She has to do other things to make up for it. So I can see where the comparisons, why you'd want to learn under her, because she wouldn't be able to do much. She looks super light, and then she goes into a match with Viper or Men and just absolutely dominates and destroys them. So
exactly,
certainly someone. So is NXT UK like a goal to get to these people, or have you got like an overarching Japan, Europe?
I mean, obviously, I'd love obviously to get the opportunity to do these things. It's not for me like dead set that's what I want to do. Like, I mean, I enjoy it, but I just don't fully see kind of like me being like NXT level. But I don't know if that's just a bit of self-confidence. Like, obviously, I mean, if they came champion, I wouldn't exactly shut the door on them. But I mean, if I work hard enough, I probably could find the confidence. But even just like going to like seminars, like hopefully they start running more seminars, and like obviously if NXT allows, like WWE allow, they can, I can start learning for them for like seminars or like training sessions, just that kind of thing now. And then hopefully one day I feel like I'm confident enough to start putting myself out there a bit more. So
That's the cool thing about, I mean, a lot of bad things have happened during the last year, of course, because, you know, Corona. But the one thing that seems to be coming out of it is the advent of web seminars or webinars, I think they're called. So you've got guys like FPWA, you've got Looking Sharp's Dojo. Just being able to get people like, I think Andy had Viper and that, and you wouldn't think it's so readily accessible now. It's almost like you don't have any excuse to
learn
nowadays. It's just well, I mean, even myself, I was in Krieger's one for Looking Sharp Dojo just because I was invited to listen in, and I was writing notes. I was looking at it, go, why am I writing notes? I'm not doing this. But somehow I was compelled to write notes.
Every time they seem to happen, I seem to obviously be in a shift. Like, it just seems so inconvenient, and I'm like, can I just phone in sick?
So, and it's like, no, we stopped everything. We stopped all wrestling so you could heal. So you're gonna have to take the hit on this one.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's because like your favourites, of course, Looking Sharp, you said, captivated you. But in the wider world of wrestling, is there anyone that you kind of inspired by, or was just anyone when you started watching WWE and that you loved? Who were your kind of inspirations?
I mean, I've got to say, probably the person in WWE that I look up to the most is Becky Lynch. Like, I know she's away there now and she'll be having babies and all that jazz, but just like the kind of like Irish girl that didn't really have any kind of claim to her name, like she wasn't well known, and she just worked her way up. And now look at her, like she is like the like one of the most kind of like, how do I explain, like she's one of the characters that everyone appeals to. Like she's just like, she never actually like came for, like, obviously you've got Charlotte Flair that had Ric Flair, and she came in from a family of wrestlers, and then you've got Becky that literally just joined a wrestling school and now she's like high up in WWE. I mean, even the same as Nikki Cross, like just joined a wrestling school and now look at her. Like, she'll be tagging me Alexa Bliss. I mean, I don't know if that's a thing anymore, but I mean, I would die in the spot if I get told I was tagging me Alexa Bliss. But just these, I'm kind of more inspired by the wrestlers that kind of just came out of nowhere. Like, even Alexa Bliss herself, like, her kind of background story appeals to me, because she's one of the people that suffered as well for being really thin, and everyone just kind of, like, laughed at her, like, really? Like, and then became a bodybuilder. Like, these are the kind of things that I appeal to, because I'm that wrestler where everyone just looks at me like, you're a wrestler, really? The size of you. Like, and, I mean, I always go like, ah, well, my speed makes up for my size kind of thing. Like, it doesn't, it's not something that would ever offend me, because I'm like, these kind of WWE wrestlers were me once, like, probably getting the same kind of rubbish, like, oh, look at the size of you, are you sure you're a wrestler? And now look at them, like, literally.
I appreciate that, because, yeah, I'm more interested in how the stories now for that, exactly that, Becky Lynch. I mean, there's even a Funko Pop made of her, which, you know, that's just nuts to think that, someone who, oh, I got off Facebook Marketplace, it was great. Boy, sold me for Fiverr. I know, I couldn't believe it. It's seeing, like, a Nikki Cross. I saw her wrestle, and first show I went to back in 2012, I saw her wrestle Sami Zayn.
Yeah.
Now, Sami's doing All Right For Herself down in EVE and then WXW, yeah. And then Nikki Cross is wrestling at WrestleMania. And
yeah, exactly. It's crazy.
The same with Drew. I mean, Drew started in a post office with Jake the Snake Roberts, and now is a two-time WWE champion. It's just
exactly like what happened there.
It goes to show. I mean, doesn't matter who you are, as long as you put in the work, then
yeah,
there's every chance that Rosie Nyte will be main event in WrestleMania with Alexa Bliss,
with Becky Lynch, hopefully.
Both of them, why not? Triple threat.
Why not? All of them.
Alexa Bliss, I love her. And not just because of like the obvious reasons, but because she's, yeah, every time she speaks, she's like just a massive like Disney nerd. And
she is, isn't she?
I love it. That, again, back to my wedding, that's where I went on honeymoon. I love Disneyland. So that's the first place I'm going when the world opens again.
I mean, I'm booked to go to Orlando for November, so Corona better just leave, because I've got a Caribbean cruise and 10 days in Disney, so leave Corona.
that's where we're hoping, we're planning Orlando, and I've got to have a look at the Performance Center, even if it's just like pressing my head against the door, just go and let me in.
I mean, that's probably what I'll do. I'll probably disappear for a day just to press my head and be like, look at me.
I've got my gear, let me in.
Hi, hello.
So I mean, you said that you could yap for days, and I feel like we're going to do that for the whole time. So we've got a couple more things, and then we'll do social media, and then have the rest of our evening, because it is Monday as of recording. We've got you down as the pop punk princess. What's your music taste like then? I'm assuming pop punk. But what's your favourite bands?
My favourite band is A Day to Remember. they are my favourite pop punk band. I've still not seen them live. I was supposed to see them live at Download, and then Rona happened. So looks like I'm not going to download. But probably closely following them is probably Biffy Clyro. So they're my favourites.
I thought I liked Biffy Clyro, and I went to go see them and realised I did not know any of their songs. I knew one album. I knew, whatever one with the flags on it. That's the only album I'd heard of, and I stood there for 2 hours listening to this going, I don't know this one. I don't know this one either. And then going, I haven't played Bubbles. And then the encore happened, it was the first one they played. It's like, oh God, spent 2 hours here, and that's the only one I've heard of so far.
Was that Bella Houston?
No, it was AACC. It was just Aberdeen.
Oh, right.
But yeah, it was £80 we spent for tickets for 3 songs that I'd heard of. It was.
Oh my God.
But flip side, I went to go see Fall Out Boy and thinking that only knew 4 songs.
I love Fall Out Boy.
Yeah, I thought, oh, I know a couple of songs. And I went there and knew all of them. And I was like, this is amazing. This is the best night ever.
I know, but I mean, my music taste is very, very strange. Like, 1 minute I could be listening to, like, A Day to Remember, and then the next minute I've got, like, ABBA songs coming on, or Elvis, like, or Disney songs. Like, my music taste is so random. Like, the other day there, a Singing Kettle song came on in the car, and I was, like, absolutely buzzing. Like, I just don't have any, like, standard. Like, when I was, like, 16, it was, like, primarily pop, punk, heavy metal. And then as I grew older, it was, like, I really want to listen to Whitney Houston on repeat.
Hamilton seems to be the popular choice of music in my
house. Very popular.
Although to the point where I'm like, right, we're going to have to go see it at some point. That's just going to have to happen.
That to my partner as well. I was like, we need to go see Hamilton because I've had enough of it. Everyone's shouting about it and I don't know anything about it.
Oh, well, it's on Disney Plus, so add that to your list. But yeah, we're going to have to go see it live. But no, I was told, right, make a list of musicals. I love musicals, but
I'm a big theatre nerd.
I've only seen Footloose in theatre. That is it.
I've seen lots.
I hated the film, but I liked the musical. So I've been told, right, I'll make a list of musicals you want to see, and we'll try and hit them one a year. So with Jersey Boys, I want to see so badly.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm now blanking which ones I wanted to see, because of course I am, because I'm speaking about it now. But yeah, I've got Hairspray. Is there one? Hairspray. I don't want to see that.
Oh, I've seen Hairspray. It's so good.
Oh, man, I love the film. It's just incredible.
Oh, it's great, isn't it?
Right, this is just going into a natter instead. So I think we've spoken about everything about wrestling in your career.
Yeah.
I'm sure there'll be many stories to be told in the future.
There's stuff incoming. I'll keep quiet about it, but there's something incoming.
I can't wait to check it. I think I'm actually remembering. I think I have seen you wrestle once, Inverness.
Rotten. Is it Rotten Wrestle? Was it
Rock and Wrestle? Yeah.
That was that. And was that against Angel or?
I think it was. Yes, it probably was. Quite possibly it was.
Probably, but more than likely.
But yeah, I mean, I've already seen stuff on YouTube and that, but I'd already tell that you're just this absolute bundle of positivity, and I have certainly got that impression when I saw you wrestle.
Yeah.
So before we go then, where can people find you on social media?
So they can find me at Rosie Nyte UK on Twitter, and on Facebook they can find me at Rosie Nyte. And Instagram is kind of a mixture between personal Instagram and wrestling Instagram, but it's still Rosie Nyte UK. So if you want to see photos of my dog, then that's where to go.
Is the cocktail still going?
No, my partner wasn't very happy about the cocktail remaining, so we had to.
What a sentence to end the show. But perfect. Thank you very much for speaking to me.
No problem. Thank you so much.